choice models are derived from a rationality assumption. The decision maker is assumed to solve an optimization problem. The alternative with the highest utility is supposed to be chosen. However, there are several evidences that human beings are not necessarily rational in the way assumed by random utility models. So in this video, we review some experiments that illustrate that apparent irrationality. The first experiment, proposed by Kahneman and co-authors, exposed individuals to the following trials. So what they call the short trial is that they need to immerse one hand in a cold water, 14 degrees, for 60 seconds. And the long trial, they are asked to immerse the other hand also in the cold water, 14 degrees, for 60 seconds. But after 60 seconds, they are asked to keep the hand in the water for 30 more seconds, and the temperature is slowly increased to 15 degrees. And then the individuals were asked about which one they prefer. Was it the short trial or the long trial? So for 1 second, think about what you would do. So if you had to choose between putting your hand for 60 seconds in a cold water, 14 degrees, or to put your hand for 60 seconds in cold water at 14 degrees, and then keep it for 30 more seconds until the temperature reaches 15 degrees. In the experiment, most people chose the long trial. They preferred the long trial. And now let's think about it from a modeling point of view. Let's think about the utility function. So if you write a utility function based on duration, on the one hand, you have a trial with 60 seconds, and another one with 90 seconds. And people prefer the long trial. So it means that you will deduce that the beta coefficient is positive. So the longer you keep your hand in cold water, the happier you are. And this is counterintuitive. It looks irrational. But it's just an apparent irrationality. The reason is that the duration in perception plays a very small role, actually. Of course, it plays a role, but a small one. What matters is the peak and the final moment. And in this case, the peak is the same for the two trials. I mean, 14 degrees for 60 seconds. But the final moment is not the same. So in the second try, the long one, the final moment is a little bit warmer. And actually, this experiment has been made to analyze pain in hospitals, and they reach the same type of conclusion. There was a book written by Dan Ariely in 2008 that I recommend, and this is called Predictably Irrational, and it contains a lot of experiments showing an apparent irrationality of people. And I selected a couple of examples. This is one. So there is a case where people have to choose a subscription to a journal, The Economist in this case. And they had the choice between a web-only subscription at $59, a print-only subscription at $125, and a print and web subscription at $125 as well. So first, think about what you would choose. Which one of the three would you choose? Okay? Then, let's look more carefully at this choice experiment. We have here two alternatives with the same cost. But one of them is offering less in terms of service than the other one. So this is what we call a dominated alternative. If people are rational, there is no reason to prefer print only as opposed to print and web, because you get more for the same price. Okay, so we have here a dominated alternative. Therefore, it's irrelevant. Why do you want to keep it? Nobody will ever choose it, right? So what they did was to organize an experiment where they took two groups, two independent groups of people, and For the first category, experiment one, they expose the people to the three alternatives, web-only, print-only, and print-and-web. So they included the dominated alternative. And for the second experiment, they removed the dominated alternative. So there was only web-only and print-and-web. And this is the results that they obtained. In the third experiment, 16 people chose web-only, 84 people chose print and web, and 0 chose print only, as expected. So this is consistent with what we discussed before. This alternative is dominated, so nobody chooses it. Let's now look at the results of the second experiment. In this case, 68 people chose web only, and 32 chose print and web. So this is interesting because if you compare these two experiments, the presence or absence of an irrelevant alternative because it's dominated completely change the choice probability for the other two. So if you think about utility theory, this alternative should not play any role. It's dominated. So people should evaluate the other two alternatives and calculate a utility function for each of them and select the best one. So why is it happening? Well, the presence of this alternative changes the perception of people of this choice experiment. They say, aha, so print only is 128. So actually, print and web may be actually a very good deal because I save money. It changes the perception of the value of what a printed option is. While in the second experiment, they have no reference. So they just compare web-only and print and web, and they may say, okay, in any case, I will not read the printed version, so I want to save money. Actually, this trick is used sometimes in fancy restaurants, where you see on the wine list a very expensive bottle of wine, so expensive that you don't believe anybody would pay for it. And it's true. Nobody will ever buy this bottle, but the average price of the bottles of wine that are sold by this restaurant will be higher than if this expensive bottle is not included in the menu or in the wine list. And this is exactly the same that happens here. So you put an expensive alternative which is dominated that will not be chosen. It changes the perception of the choice context. And people will prefer more expensive alternatives in average. What we have just seen in the context of the journal subscription is sometimes called the decoy effect. So the idea of a decoy is to include high-priced, low-value products compared to the other items in the choice set. And then you observe the shift of the behavior of the consumers who will then prefer more expensive items. And this is documented in the literature. I mentioned already the wine list in the restaurant, but it has been used in travel and tourism, in tobacco treatment, online diamond retail, and probably others that I didn't find. Here is another example which has been proposed by Daniel McFadden, who happens to have a vineyard and is making his own wine. And we have a similar setup. We have two experiments, and in each experiment, the list of alternatives is different. So in the first experiment, we propose a McFadden Red at $10, or a Napa Red at $12. Actually, McFadden is very well known for his contribution to economics, but not as much for his wine. So therefore, most people select two because Napa Red is known to be very good. And even if it is a little bit more expensive, people seem to prefer it. So most people would choose two. Now in the second experiment, we have again the McFadden Red at $10 and the Napa Red at $12. But now we also propose a McFadden Special Reserve Pinot Noir at $60. $60 is a very expensive wine, and actually not many people decide to choose it, but in this case, most people select this alternative, alternative one. Why? Well, again, it's about perception. Aha, McFadden is doing Special Reserve Pinot Noir, which is sold at $60. It must be pretty good wine, so it seems that the wine done by McFadden is very good. That's what I perceive But then if he's making good wine, the $10 bottle may be a very good deal and I would like to buy it. The next example has been proposed by Kahneman and Tversky, and it is about framing. How can we frame decisions? So somehow the way we ask the question will change the way people will respond. So the setup is the following. Assume that a population of 600 people is threatened by a disease. And then there are two alternative treatments that are designed to combat the disease, and people have to choose between which treatment to apply. And again, as we did in the previous example, so two independent groups of people were exposed to two different experiments. The first group was exposed to treatment A and treatment B, and the second group was exposed to treatment C and treatment D. So let's see what these treatments are. So treatment A is such that 200 people out of the 600 will be saved, while treatment B is such that 600 people will be saved, but with probability 1/3. And 0 will be saved with probability 2/3. So think about which one you would choose. A, 200 people are saved. B, 600 are saved with probability 1/3. And 0 are saved with probability 2/3. Now, because you know about mathematics, you realize that the expected number of people saved in the two cases is the same. In the second experiment, the way it was presented is the following. If you choose treatment, let's call it C, 400 people will die. While if you choose treatment D, 0 people die with probability 1/3. And 600 die with probability 2/3. So again, you can see that between treatment C and treatment D, the expected number of people who die is the same. But you should realize actually that it's also the same as in treatment A and B. So for all the four treatments, the expected number of people that you save is 200, and the expected number of people who die will be 400. And now let's see how people responded. So in each group, so the first group with 152 respondents, the second group with 155 respondents, how did they respond? In the first case, 72% of respondents preferred treatment A. While in the second group, only 22% of the respondents preferred treatment C. So this shows how the framing is important. So basically, we present exactly the same thing, but we in a different way. On the first experiment, treatment A was associated with saving people. And this is why it was selected the most. People don't like probabilistic outcome. I mean, in treatment B, you have a probability to save nobody. It's explicitly written. It's not explicitly written in treatment A. While treatment C is associated with a lot of people dying, and very few people will select this option. Okay, so they prefer treatment D, where there is a probability to save people and to save everybody. So from a mathematical point of view, these two experiments would be represented in the same way. There is no difference. But the behavior is completely different. The choice is completely different. So if you don't take into account the way things are presented, so what is the perception of people, you may completely miss the choice they make. Another example that I took from the book by Ariely is the choice between two chocolates, a fine one, which is a Swiss chocolate, which is well known, Lindt, and a regular chocolate, Hershey, which is an American brand, which is less well known. And actually, when you ask people to choose between a fine chocolate, which is quite expensive, let's say, I think in the book it was like 15 cents, as opposed to 1 cent for the Hershey, well, most people would choose the lint one. And now let's do this. Let's decrease the price of the two chocolates by 1 cent. Okay, in the context of utility theory, remember, if you decrease the utility of both alternatives by the same amount, it will not change the choice probability. So let's see how it works. So I have the choice here between a chocolate at 14 cents and a chocolate which is free, zero. And what you observed then in this case, the vast majority of people would choose the free chocolate. Why is that so? Well, one possible explanation is that in experiment one, to buy an Hershey chocolate, there is a transaction cost. You will have to take some money out of your pocket. While in experiment two, you don't have this transaction cost. So it shows that it's not only the price that will play a role, there may be something else, in this case, transaction cost. Another explanation is that the fact to be free is perceived differently as something that you have to pay for. And if you think about it, you have the same phenomena when you buy apps for your smartphone. Most of these apps are actually free, because then people download them and they may have to pay afterwards for extra add-on. While if an app has to be paid, there are less people downloading it. It's the same phenomenon. We have reviewed a few examples of experiments providing evidence of apparent irrationality of decision makers. In the pain lovers example, the nature of the utility function happens not to be intuitive. Remember, we had the peak and the last moment of the experiment that mattered. In the economist example, we have illustrated the decoy effect, which is well studied in marketing. In the wine example, we have illustrated how the perception of attributes can be modified. In the live and let die example, we have illustrated the framing of decisions. The way you ask the question will change the way it is answered. And in the chocolate example, we have illustrated possible discontinuities in the utility function, where zero may have a very specific meaning as opposed to 0.01. Now the question is, from a modeling point of view, how do we take these aspects into account in discrete choice models? And this is what we will see in the next videos.